Price of Fear. Brought to you by Vincent Price.
Hello, welcome. This story, which I've called Soul Music, involved me purely by chance. Due to some slight technical failure, the nonstop flight I'd been booked on for filming commitments in Rome was diverted to Paris. And there in the refreshment lounge at Orly Airport, I met up again with Marianne. I spotted her several minutes before she saw me, but the recognition was as immediate as if the intervening years had never been. The same cool, poised awareness, even in that overcrowded, bustling setting. A kind of inner apartness. It would be difficult to describe. It made the frustrations of the flight, even the possibility of an overnight stop, only too worthwhile. The fact that her husband, the international violinist David Clementis, was bound to be traveling with her, in music circles they had long been nicknamed the Inseparables, offered the opportunity of a double treat.
Oh, my dear Vincent, it's sweet of you to say so.
Some cream?
Thank you.
Well, then, out with it. How's the maestro?
Oh, David's fine.
Well, more to the point, where's the maestro? Well, let's face it, the old crowd always referred to the two of you as the Inseparables.
Inseparable? Oh, yes. Yes, they did, didn't they?
Now, don't tell me. You've got him lurking underneath the table. Stradivarius tuned and at the ready. Well, what's it to be, romance or a touch of Ochichonia?
Well, David came on ahead, an earlier flight.
Oh?
Well, no, nothing mysterious. Partly business agents, an impresario. Well, you know the whirl. Besides, he's never appeared in this particular hall before, and in violin circles it's got a reputation as a dead house. He suddenly got a bit jittery about the acoustics.
Typical David.
Huh?
Well, always the perfectionist.
Yes. Yes, he was, wasn't he?
Marianne, you all right?
Yeah, well, I'm fine. I'm just a bit tired, but I'm fine.
Global Air regret to announce the cancellation of their flight 108 to Rome. Passengers are requested to report to the inquiry desk for details of overnight accommodation and alternative bookings for the continuation of their journey.
Well, that settles it, doesn't
Mesdames,
it? Well, what could be nicer? A night on the town in gay Paris, all courtesy of good old Global Air. To begin with, you can wangle me a ticket for the maestro's concert. Even if it does mean swinging from one of the chandeliers.
Oh, but
I insist. And afterwards, I'll come backstage, whisk him away from the backslappers, and carry the pair of you off to a secret little bistro I've been saving in Montmartre. Food before decor. And just the three of us.
Oh, but surely, if you've got an early morning flight to catch...
Marianne, is anything the matter? It's almost as though you'd rather I stayed well clear.
No, it's nothing really. Nothing in the world. It's really wonderful seeing you again.
You think the same will go for David?
David? Well, of course. Why should it be otherwise?
My ticket for the concert was waiting for me at the box office, as promised. The attendant handed it across coolly. No, almost contemptuously. I'd expected some kind of covering note from either Marianne or David, but there was none. I passed through the heavy velvet curtains and stood at the back of the circle. There was no usher to examine my ticket, but then there seemed little need. At a generous estimate, I reckon, the whole house could have been moved forward and still barely filled the front three rows. Their mild enthusiasm proved premature. Sufficient to say the performance was a travesty. The adverse notices completely justified. But it wasn't until the interval, grateful for my oversized cognac in the crush bar, that I tried to grasp the cause, the reason for what I'd just witnessed. I settled for one word, contempt. Contempt on the part of the soloist. It summed up his attitude and performance exactly. Even visually, the violinist at the center of this indifference was a grotesque of the David Clementis I remembered. The soloist whose charm and superlative talent had won hearts and critical acclaim in every major concert hall in the world. A veritable travesty of the immaculate, assured Clementis, whose famous profile even now stared out of the display cases that lined the walls. Contempt. Not only for that fast diminishing audience, but for himself too. But most of all, contempt for that supreme talent that he had nurtured and that they had adulated for so long. But why? In God's name, why? I must have spoken the thought, because suddenly I was aware of Marianne standing beside me. But not the Marianne of the airport. Now she was making no attempt to hide the hurt, the need within her.
I'd hoped you might not come, that they might have found you a place on an earlier flight. But now that you have... Do you think I might have a cognac, too?
Oh, but of course. Encore un cognac.
Monsieur.
How long?
What, like this? A year or so after our marriage. In the early days, it seemed our love had made his talent flourish. But it wasn't till the pact had been signed and sealed, so to speak, that I began to notice the change.
But what could have changed him? Why?
No, let me ask the question. Now, before I came along, what would you have said was David's one love? The all-consuming passion, the reason for his very existence.
What a strange way to put it.
The reason for his very existence.
Well, I suppose...
No. Don't suppose. Admit it.
All right. His music.
His only love. It had possessed him from the very beginning, exclusively, uncompromisingly. He had no life beyond the rehearsal room or the concert platform. The demands made by this God-given talent was all that he'd known until we met and loved. And I taught him to share my world. Other interests, other people, other places. And therefore, I displaced the total dedication, the exclusiveness of this talent. I broke the absolute stranglehold of whatever power had possessed him before.
Possessed? Why do you use the word possessed?
It's a strong word, isn't it?
Yes.
In the Dark Ages, they applied it to witches and warlocks and burned them at the stake, didn't they?
Mm.
You know, it's a word we hardly ever use now. We prefer to skirt the issue. But the talent David had possessed him as surely and as completely as any demon. The only difference was, in his case, there could be no exorcist. None. God knows we tried. But the talent had exclusive rights, you see. It possessed him from within, his very soul. And when I'm around, as long as I'm around, it destroys him from within and leaves him, well, the broken doll that you saw standing there tonight.
You know, Marianne, the ancient Egyptians believed that the soul was a very real, substantial thing. That it had an actual physical location, just like any other organ, the heart, the liver, the spleen. They tried to locate it, to preserve it, to sanctify and deify it in their Coptic jars.
A couple of thousand years on, and we're only too anxious to deny its very existence. But it's there, all right. In David's case, it's in his hands. The soul talent is locked in his two hands. In the fingers. That through his music, can create a heaven or a hell. Not only for himself, but for anyone who dares to interfere with it or displace it. I tried, but I failed.
Failed? But you've done so much for him. How could you have failed?
Oh, David admits it too. Just now you witnessed his public admission. Surely as any warlock suffering from the tortures of the Inquisition, waiting for the fires of hell to be lit and the agonies of hell to begin.
But if what you say is true...
Well, I know it to be. That's why I'm leaving him, Vincent.
Leaving him?
Don't you understand? I have no choice. I can't watch the doll dance. Not once, but over and over again. Open to the scorn and contempt of anyone who chooses to pay the price of admission. I can't afford to pay the price of admission anymore.
You desert him to this force?
It's his only chance. It's a fair exchange. My misery for the price of his salvation.
Well, I'd better get on.
No, don't go back. You needn't. He doesn't know you're here.
And if he did?
I know he'd not expect it.
But of course I'd damn well expect it, my love. A straightforward case of rally round the flag, isn't it, Vincent, old buddy?
Oh, you know, David. That...
Mark you, the ralliers are lying a bit thin on the ground this season, but then that's only to be expected, isn't it? Well, damn you, isn't it?
Oh, darling, there's no need.
There's every need. Oh, dear, the well seems to have run dry.
I'll ring through.
The bar will be closed, but I'm sure if you were to try using your personal charms... Please, Marianne.
Very well, David.
You know we're splitting up, Marianne and myself. She told you we were?
Yes, David, she told me.
Yes, of course she did. But she probably told you it was her idea, not mine. A supreme personal sacrifice in the cause of art.
Something like that.
Not true. It was my idea. My decision.
I see.
Well, do you think I'd honestly swap a single moment of my life with Marianne for the existence I knew before? For what now must take its place?
I don't know.
Well, take my word for it.
But, David, you still have the choice.
No choice. For Marianne's sake, you see, living with me is just not safe any longer. This force inside me is just not safe.
Why don't you try telling me about it?
There have been several occasions, incidents.
I don't think I understand.
It's quite simple. A desire to hurt, to inflict. At first, simply with a gesture, a word, until...
Go on, David, tell me.
Until in London, about a month ago, there'd been a reception after the concert. Marianne was tired and came back early to the hotel. I remember getting back myself in the early hours of the morning. I went into the bedroom. I watched her sleeping there. And then, suddenly, my hands... God! My hands about her throat. Possessed. With a will, a volition, all of their own, pressing harder, harder, until, just as suddenly, it stopped. No hate anymore, only remorse. Remorse and the decision that it should never happen again, ever again. But it's still there, you see. In the hands... A force over which there can be no control.
And the alternative? If you choose not to accept it, not to release it?
Pain, certainly. And perhaps, ultimately, a hell beyond anything man has ever known. As the soul fights the body to get free, and the body fights back to imprison it. The pain of tearing as the soul tries to get out.
For what seemed an eternal moment, my friend studied the frail eloquence of his hands holding the tumbler. Then, with an inner force that seemed totally their own, they jerked convulsively. The crystal tumbler lay in 1,000 razor-edged splinters at his feet. That, as it turned out, was to be my last meeting with David. And the next day, I flew on to Rome. But I did hear from Marianne. We'd just finished some location sequences at a small fishing village when her letter arrived. There'd been a long delay in its forwarding. The postmark, Paris, a good month earlier. I opened it with an almost positive conviction of what I would find.
I know what a shock this will be to you. David collapsed as soon as we got back to the hotel that night. By the time we got him to the hospital, there was nothing to be done. You will see from one of the clippings, the jury at the coroner's hearing recorded an open verdict. But I think we, anyway, know only too well there was a very real, if inexplicable, cause. Let it remain our secret. The price David paid for his unique talent was finally exacted in full, and in a manner so bizarre, I find it impossible to embark on here. But if the final awful proof should interest you, and you are returning via Paris, please ring me at this number, and I will arrange a meeting with Dr. Emile Fouchard. I have already told him he may expect to hear from us, and that he is to hold nothing, I repeat, nothing, back. We owe you this. Besides, to know is to share. Marianne.
To know is to share. But to know what? To share what? What was it that eventually persuaded me to do exactly as Marianne asked? To ring her number, arrange an appointment, and finally find myself seated in the good doctor's surgery-come-consulting room, just off the Rue Madeleine.
To hold nothing back. It's easily said, monsieur. But where does the knowing end and the disbelief begin?
Vincent, you have the right to know.
Well, the simple facts and findings related to my friend's death. They might prove as good a starting point as any.
The simple facts, eh? Eh bien, so be it. Here it is. As presented in testimony at the coroner's court, for which there is allowed no room for speculation or error. A summary of these facts, then. Several witnesses of your friend's collapse in the foyer of his hotel, his admission to the Hôpital de la Vierge on the Île de la Cité, the inescapable fact that he was pronounced dead on arrival, the admitting physician diagnosed heart failure, brought about by blood clotting, brought about by an excessive consumption of alcohol.
I see.
And so I thought, did I?
I'm sorry?
I suspect that Madame omitted to inform you that during his stay in Paris, I acted as her late husband's physician.
No, it's true. I finally managed to persuade David he might benefit from some kind of treatment.
My initial examination of the patient was thorough and exhaustive. I gave it as my considered opinion that the root cause of Monsieur Clémenti's malady was mental rather than physical, which is why I used all my influence to be allowed to assist at the postmortem. Vindication, vanity, call it what you will. Eventually it was achieved. Have you ever witnessed a postmortem, monsieur?
Oh, no, no.
Then, if you are not of an over-squeamish disposition, I shall attempt to enlighten you. To begin with, then, to the casual observer, it is more an object lesson in butchery than surgery. Rather the slaughterhouse than the operating theater. The instruments we employ, for the most part anyway, might be purchased in any quincaillerie, hardware shop, you know. The ultimate object of the exercise is to arrive at the vital organs, the brain, heart, the lungs, the stomach and its contents, with the maximum of efficiency and the minimum of subtlety.
Yes, I understand.
To this end, then, a hacksaw and cold chisel for the removal of the cranium cap, the ribs and the sternum, a scoop for the removal of the brain, a butcher's knife for pussing out the heart sac, the stomach and lung cavities. Some fresh air, perhaps.
Thank you.
A butcher's trade. So much offal to be removed, examined, disposed of, and then replaced with sufficient stuffing material as will persuade the bereaved relatives that their dear departed is as complete and unsullied as when he first came into our charge.
And as a result of this butchery?
We found nothing. Positively nothing that in any way affected my original opinion that the person I'd examined in this office not so many days before was as fit as anyone of his age, constitution, and occupation could be expected to be. Allow. Cause of death? Inconclusive. Consequence?
An open verdict.
And duly recorded for anyone to read.
Well, then what's the mystery?
Occurrences. Yes. Let us call them occurrences. The nature and reason for which we can only speculate.
Go on.
The cadaver of your late friend was placed in one of the wall cabinets with which every dissecting room is equipped. A kind of container, you understand, large enough to accommodate a corpse, but otherwise similar to the kind of filing cabinet you'd find among any office furnishing.
Yes, I understand.
I felt sure you would.
Well, and then?
The cabinet was locked.
Locked? Is that customary?
As I explained at the time to Madame, reserved mainly for celebrities, in view of the current excessive curiosity of the popular press. Just a precaution, you understand.
Yes.
On the very next day, a complaint from Monsieur Corbeau, the artist, was delivered by hand. The very next day.
Corbeau? But where does Corbeau come
into it? Well, David had long ago agreed that Corbeau should one day be allowed to make a cast of his hands.
Oh.
But it was a long-standing, well, a life-standing agreement. When he read of David's death, he asked if I now had any reason to refuse that request.
And?
Well, no reason. In fact, it gave me a kind of comfort, a memento for posterity.
Doctor, you said Corbeau made a complaint.
Yes, within hours of the remains being put at his disposal.
I still have his letter, Vincent. Perhaps you'd like to read it for yourself.
Macabre. Grotesque. Satanic. Defilement. But what does he mean?
In that, too, you must judge for yourself. But first, I must stress that at no time, not right up until the locking of the cabinet, had we dissected or performed any pathological examination on the hands of the deceased. We had no reason to. They would have told us nothing. Some photographs. These, taken before the cabinet was locked.
Yes, I see. Palm to palm. Total repose.
And these, taken immediately after the complaint of Monsieur Corbeau had been received.
To know is to share, Vincent.
You'd never have recognized them for hands. They'd been severed. No, they'd been torn away from the rest of the limb. Each joint cracked, the flesh bloated and pistulated, as though all the time, during the hell-like ritual of that post-mortem, as the surgeon butchers went about their casual ritual of carving, hacking, and scooping, the living soul captured within was screaming for escape. A living hell. To lie on a marble slab, eyes expressionless, unblinking, tongue mute, grotesquely protruding through the cavern of the larynx, simply lying there, knowing it, experiencing it, waiting only for the tortures of the hell to stop, for the chance finally to break free, and for the soul music to begin. To know is to share. I made my way back to the hotel. It was raining. At a corner, a street musician sawed forlornly away on his violin. He seemed surprised at the charity I dropped into his cap. But there was no joy in the tune he played.
That was Vincent Price bringing you The Price of Fear. Also starring in soul music was Coral Brown, with John Graham, Roger Snowden, and Michael Burnington. Soul music was first recounted and dramatized by William Ingram and produced by John Dias.